Good evening. My name is Pat Ryan. Welcome to Chicago Founder Stories here at 1871, Chicago's new digital startup hub. We have a great story tonight for you, the winner of last year's Momentum Award, the founder of Cleversafe, Chris Gladwin. Chris, great to have you here.
Thanks. Great to be here. Thank you.
So, Chris, Cleversafe is a really exciting story, a really interesting and big technology idea, but a lot of people, you know, may never have been exposed to it. How would you explain to the layperson what Cleversafe does?
Well, basically what Cleversafe is doing is storing the world's data. That's our intention, is to build the technology to store all the data in the world.
Storing the world's data.
Yeah.
That's a big startup idea.
Yeah, you know, my friends kind of almost give me a hard time because I tend to gravitate toward big ideas. But the reality is the world's going to make a lot of data and a lot more. I mean, it's just this ever-accelerating demand. And the solutions that existed prior to Cleversafe just simply weren't going to be able to do it.
So who would buy Cleversafe today? Like, who would be a quintessential customer?
Yeah, so we essentially hear a lot about cloud storage, cloud computing. We make clouds. So people that sell storage in a cloud service, they have to get that from someone. And you really have two options. You can either build it yourself or you can buy it from us. Kind of how that works. So if you have a very large amount of data to store, billions of photos, millions of hours of video, all genomes for everyone in the United States, something like that, that would be ideal.
All the genomes for people in the United States.
Yeah, that's going to happen. There was there's a new genome sequencing machine that just came out. And to put this in perspective, in 2000, 5 years ago, the Human Genome Project completed sequencing the first complete genome of a person for $15 billion. Wow. A machine that just came out can sequence a gene, like the whole thing, not like 23andMe where it just picks a couple things, but like the whole, every base pair, for $1,000. Hmm. So it used to cost $15 billion, cost $1,000.
Wow.
So what that means is not, well, we're just going to sequence a couple more genes and save a lot of money. What that means is we're going to sequence a million times more genes. And so, going back to that quintessential customer, so one of our customers and more of our customers are in this situation. You're the head of storage for a genome research organization. You know, the old machines, actually, the generation before these, they cost $10,000 each.
And what kind of machines are you replacing in that case? What were the old machines in this particular case?
Well, I'm talking about the gene sequencing machines that make the data.
Okay.
The new one just came out that's $1,000 per.
Okay, right. Yep.
It's one-tenth the cost of the old one. So what that means, if you're the head of storage, you essentially had this fire hose of data that was coming at you from the $10,000 machine, $10,000 per genome. And the company that makes the $1,000 gene sequencer has so much demand, they said, we're only going to sell to customers that buy 10. Okay? So your company just bought 10 of these things, and now they're pumping out genes for $1,000 each. So now that hose of data that you used to have to store, which was pretty big, just got at least 10 times bigger.
Right.
And all those bits are spraying at you, and you've got to store them all. And that's exactly the kind of problem we would solve.
I know you've taken it to another level, but what was the system that would have stored it before? What was the pre-Cleversafe best thing we had?
Well, the way that the world stores data today is it makes copies. So data is always just some string of numbers. A gene sequence is just a string of numbers. A picture is just a string of numbers. A video is a string of numbers. And the methods that the world has used up until now has been just to take that string of numbers and point it at some kind of media, like a tape or a disk or something like that, and just store those numbers in order. Mm-hmm. And they do a couple other things, like they'd occasionally calculate the sum of the numbers and store that. That's called a parity bit. So that if one of the numbers is missing, you could subtract all the ones you have and recalculate mm-hmm. the one that's missing. That was and then the other technique that the industry used before us was, if that wasn't good enough, well, then we'll make a second copy, and if that's not good enough, we'll make a third copy,
right.
In case the building burns down or something like that. So that was the entire state of the art for technology for the $40 billion enterprise storage market before Cleversafe. And if you kind of come from the world that I do, which is wireless communications and networking, although I've done some storage products, I've done more wireless and networking products, those techniques that are being used for that $40 billion storage market are equivalent to what wireless and networking was doing in around 1970, 1980.
Wow.
Okay. Now, in the wireless world, they're much more sophisticated. They've virtualized the data.
Why did this part of the industry stay so far behind? I mean, so much investment in other parts of information technology and related industries. What is it about this area that kept them from keeping up the way?
It's classic innovator's dilemma. So if I'm a big vendor, and the enterprise storage market is essentially an oligopoly. There's seven companies. You guys can probably name who they are: EMC, IBM, Hitachi Data Systems, Dell, HP, et cetera, that control about 90% of that market. So they have systems where if you need more reliability, you have to buy a second copy. And if you need even more reliability, you buy a third copy. Mm-hmm. So that means I'm selling you three times as much. You know, and maybe four times as much because of all those parity bits. So that's a pretty good deal for you. I mean, for you, the vendor. Not so great for the customer. So they are structurally disincented to change that gravy train.
Right.
That's why.
Interesting. So storing all the world's data is a huge idea, but not an easy thing to do. So where did the specific idea to do this come from?
Well, it came from two things. One, looking at the demand side. You know, Moore's law, which is the rate at which technology advances for computing, is pretty well known. You know, the processors get twice as fast every 2 years or so. And that has really changed the world. Now, what's been happening is there's also the rate at which data storage has been growing. And it's been growing faster than the rate at which compute has been growing. And, you know, the rate is equivalent for enterprise storage systems, big storage systems, a rate that would be equal to every 5 years, there's 10 times as much storage. And every 10 years, therefore, there's 100 times as much storage. That's crazy fast growth. So that's one thing that led to Cleversafe, like looking at that growth saying, you know, 10 years from now,
and you had 100 times. But you had a vantage point in this, too. Weren't you in, didn't you have a music business that was really used a lot of storage?
Yeah, the company I did before Cleversafe was Music Now, and we built a system that stored all music. And at the time, that was a pretty big system. I mean, now that's like barely a server. but at the time, that was a room full of equipment, and so I bought all this state of the art stuff, and I got that that pitch from the vendor, which is, look, you really need this to be reliable, right? Yeah, right. Well, then you need to buy three of everything, and we did because we didn't have a choice,
This explains why the EMC salesman I knew in the late '90s would say, I have one client I got to sell once, and then I just have to wait the rest of the year. I play golf and I go make sure they're happy.
Yeah, it's selling storage is a great business because your customer constantly has to buy more. I mean, computing is something that you use. You use a computer, then you can use it again. Storage is something you consume. You use it once, and you got to buy more. Right. And actually, in the kinds of businesses we deal with, they don't just have to buy one times as much more. They have to buy more than one times as much more every time they buy it. It just keeps getting bigger and bigger.
Hmm. Interesting. So let's go back in time, because this is obviously an interesting path how you got here, which we've talked a little bit about. So talk a little bit about where you grew up. What were you like as a kid? The man who wants to store all the world's data. Where did you grow up? And talk about what you like to do as a kid.
Well, I guess as a kid, I was like a kid. One thing that I think distinguished me is I always had a job. I was always making money. From a very early age, like age 12. I had savings, and I had stocks that I owned, at a very young
age. So word on the street is you had the world's largest paper route.
I had a big paper route, from a very young age, and I used to make a lot of money. And, I had a very efficient paper route because I lived in an apartment area.
You optimized your paper route?
Yeah. I mean, I had opportunities to get other paper routes that I turned down, and then there were some that I took. And, what I really liked was...
You did M&A of paper routes?
Yeah. Yeah, there was a vetting process.
Wow.
And what I liked was...
You were 12.
Starting at age 12, was a paper route where it was an apartment area. Because in an apartment area, all the deliveries, the doors, are very close to each other. So you could deliver, 120
papers.
You were
factoring in density to your paper route business?
Yeah, and then, if you had houses, it would take you twice as long.
Wow. Well... If you can't guess where he went to college after optimizing his paper route based on density, So you're entrepreneurial. You're getting different jobs. You're doing things. You're making money. I think at one point you told me that you're making more money than some of the parents you knew.
Correct. Well, so then my parent, yes.
Than your parent.
Than my mom. I was making more money than her at times.
And so you're very successful, but you go to MIT.
Yep.
And so what's a boy from Columbus, Ohio, thinking when he goes to MIT, and what's it like when you actually get there?
Well, I didn't, honestly, I didn't really realize how valuable MIT would be and how important that was. I was very fortunate. I'll actually tell you how I picked to go to MIT. One of my friends was asking me, I think it was my senior year, well, where are you going to college? Like, I don't know. Well, have you applied? Have you, thought about that? Like, no. So he's like, he took me to the library, and he's like, well, what do you want to study? Like, engineering. What kind? I have no idea. So I looked up, engineering, and I wanted a school that had all the departments of engineering, because I didn't know if I wanted to be aeronautical or electrical or mechanical or whatever, and MIT was like on every list, So I'm like, all right, well, I think I'll go there. So I went there, and I really didn't realize until after I left, in some ways, how transformational that was for me. I mean, it changed me, into a person that, really had, perspective and, marketable skill and could do, these kinds of things like, build a system and store all the data in the world. You don't just wake up one day and know how to do that. I mean, a lot of people have to teach you a lot of things to get to that point.
So how, you said, you talked about not sure what kind of engineer you wanted to be, wanted to try different. So talk about what you chose to be, why, and how you chose that.
Well, when I was in college, I changed my major every semester, which wasn't a really great plan, but it was really interesting. I was like every semester I'd pick a new major for a while. And then I got to my junior year, and my advisor was like, you got to stop this. You just pick one, get your degree, get it over with. So I picked mechanical engineering is what I ended up getting my degree in.
And so why mechanical engineering?
Because I'm very spatial and very visual. And it was just, it was just easy to get done in 2 years. It was one thing because I was already a junior and I kind of had to crank. And I didn't want to keep, going more than 4 years. And, and I just enjoyed it as a simple reason.
Well, especially in that time, CS wasn't as far along as it obviously was later. You could make things. I mean, the Mackeys I knew back in school, they really liked making things.
Yeah.
And and you have some great entrepreneurs. My January guest, Godard Abel, founder of Big Machines and G2 Crowd, he's a mechanical engineer from MIT.
Yeah, pretty
so
cool.
It's a good pedigree. So you graduate, and it's the 80s.
It was 1986.
86. So it's 1986. You graduate. And what height of the Cold War, Ronald Reagan.
Yeah, height of the Cold War.
What do you decide to do?
I went and worked at a defense contractor, Martin Marietta, which is now part of Lockheed Martin. And I'd started a company in college that did computer consulting that was pretty successful. So even though my degree was in mechanical engineer, my main job in college was with computers. And personal computers in particular. So I went to a large corporation that bought, in today's dollars, something like $1 billion a year of IT products. And I was one of the people that would evaluate those and, select, which one would be the corporate standard for our email or spreadsheets and things like that. So essentially I was a professional customer, which was great, great experience. Like that's all I did was I was a customer evaluating technology and computer products.
Interesting. And so you end up leaving there and come to Chicago at some point.
Yeah, so one of the big vendors that we bought our PCs from was Zenith Data Systems, which was located here. And at the time, Zenith Data Systems was the biggest PC, portable PC maker in the world.
And this was the part of the Zenith TV maker.
There were two, at that time there were two parts. There was Zenith Data Systems, and then there was Zenith Electronics. It was a TV business, but not what it once was. It was a fading TV business, and we were the personal computer business, and they had split off into two different companies.
Got
so
it.
I was in the computer business.
Got it.
And so then, having been a professional customer, I then switched to being the vendor side, making computers. And so that gave me the opportunity to learn, you know, all the aspects of what it takes to make a computer product, you know, product marketing, product strategy, product development, you know, all those different things.
And how long were you there? Because at some point, I think you spun out of that, didn't you?
Yeah, so I was there 5.5 years, and, you know, at the end, toward the end, I was responsible for all the new stuff, you know, so anything that wasn't a desktop computer, a server, or a laptop, that was my domain. And we had developed a new technology, which was for tablet computers and wireless tablet computers.
What year did you invent the iPad?
I wouldn't say I invented the iPad, but we had 27 different patents related to wireless tablets. And a lot of things in the iPad now I look at, and I remember coming up with those, you know, me and the team, like the software keyboard, you know, we did that, a bunch of stuff like that.
And what year was that?
That would have been from 1994 to 1998 kind of time frame.
So you come up with this thing. It's obviously, you know, way ahead of its time.
If it would have been more obvious, we wouldn't have done it, because it was way too ahead of its time.
Right. Yeah. But at the time, so you come up with it. How cool could you make the technology using 1990s resources?
Oh, it was cool. I mean, we were on the cover of Popular Science. You know, we had feature articles on Wired. I mean, it was cool. The challenge was, I mean, I look at this thing now, and I'm like so jealous, man. The guys that make that product, like, the radio in this product is a chip, and it has everything in it, and you're just done. You just put the chip on, you know, and it's literally 10,000 times faster than the one we had to make from scratch. And you could sell this to a customer today and assume that they've got wireless and assume they've got Ethernet and internet. That didn't happen when we made what they were called cruise pads. So accessories that we sold with the cruise pad were wireless routers. Like, customers didn't have them. Like, wow. And the other accessories, we had to say to the customer, do you have Ethernet? Do you have internet?
So and they didn't what have was the, so what was the use case crazy. Given all the things you had to do with it?
So because of that, we would have to sell into environments where they would have, you know, a lot of need. So the markets we sold into were vehicle maintenance, you know, like if you're maintaining, you know, military aircraft, or big healthcare organizations, or big warehouse organizations. And there they had like 10,000 workers. And so even though it was kind of a hassle, like, to go out and get this weird thing called the internet and put in this strange stuff called Ethernet and this wireless, it was all new, you could justify that because it would be like 10,000 workers are going to get more efficient.
You spin out with this cool tablet, early tablet technology.
Yep.
And talk about what, you know, how'd that go? That was your first technology entrepreneurial venture, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, my first big one. I had started a couple smaller things, but this is the first, you know, venture-backed, big-scale, 50-people kind of company. So, you know, we got it working, you know, and I looked back, and it was like so much engineering was required to make that thing work. We sold thousands of them, and, you know...
What was the price point back then?
Oh, my. Like $5,000 each,
wow.
Something like that. They were maybe $2,000. They were thousands of dollars. I mean, it's a whole different world. I mean, not only are they... Like this, not only is this radio 10,000 times faster, it's 10,000 times cheaper. I mean, it was really hard to do. So what really happened in terms of that business was the fundamental proposition was that the industry was going through a change. It had been dominated by the PC architecture and the PC ecosystem, and there was this new trend toward what were called network computers. And three major companies were leading this transformation. You know, Sun, Oracle, and Netscape were kind of driving this new kind of network computer, the idea of a computer that's always connected to the network. And it's essentially a thin client. And so they were kind of leading that, and what we made was wireless network computers. And so the idea was, you know, they were the dog, we were the tail. You know, they're gonna do the heavy lifting, take on Intel and Microsoft, and we'll be right behind you. And even though they spent, you know, tons of money, I think in reality we sold more wireless network computers than they sold wired.
Wow.
And that was the problem. Yeah. Because little Cleversafe was not going to take on Intel and Microsoft. And once, you know, that kind of front line of those three guys faded, we did take on Intel and Microsoft, and that was difficult. So, you know, it was just not going to happen with us on our own. So even though we had success, we didn't have that support, and we ended up selling it to NEC.
So what was the lesson learned from that one? Is there one big thing you took away?
Oh, that's easy. It's do not be too far ahead of the market. You know, you can have a product and a technology that's just light years ahead of everyone and better, but if the market is not ready to take it and adopt it, it doesn't matter. You can't really push the market that much. You can maybe affect it a little bit, but you can't, you know, transform it. I mean, this arguably is the first large-scale adoption of tablets. There's been 50 tablet products.
Microsoft had famous ones.
Yeah, Grid had them. You know, I mean, we had them. And this is 20 years later. You know, so 20 years too early is not good.
Right. A lot of wisdom in that.
Yeah.
So, and how do you think you figure out you're too early? What was it, you know, makes a lot of sense. I think everybody here would say, absolutely. So, but what is it that you'd look for to say, like, if you had to do it over again, what would have been the tell for you?
Well, if I were to look at it
that
now,
that would be translatable.
I would say, you know, the customer doesn't even have a wireless infrastructure. The customers don't even have Ethernet. There's not really broad-scale use of the Internet in corporate America. These are things we need, okay? Mm-hmm. Until the, like, so if you look at a market and you say,
so kind of the enabling infrastructure.
If it's not there, you're not going to make it there. I mean, right. It's going to get there when it's going to get there, and you're not going to make the world suddenly adopt, you know, internet at a pace faster than it's going to adopt. So
that makes sense. So, but you start another company shortly there, not too far thereafter.
Yeah, right after.
So talk about that story. What was next and why? More importantly, why?
Yeah, so the next one I started was a company called Music Now. Originally it was called Full Audio, and then we changed it to Music Now. And on that one, I really wanted to get the timing right. So the fundamental premise of Music Now was that music was going to become a digital business. You know, previously, music was distributed on CDs, a physical plastic object. No one played music on computers. It just didn't happen. It was this concept that hadn't really, hadn't been accepted and wasn't quite technically feasible. And so the idea was, as soon as the average bandwidth to the average American home is about equal to how much a person can hear. In other words, as soon as the bandwidth is big enough to send enough data down it, that it kind of sounds to a human ear like high-quality sound. And as soon as the average size of a compressed digital music collection is equal to about a third of a hard drive, you know, as hard drives get bigger at some point, you know, it crosses over. As soon as those two things happen, music's going to go digital. That was the premise. And so, you know, you could kind of run the numbers and see, like, oh, here's bandwidth going, and here's hard drives going, and here's where they cross over. And so, all right. Music's going digital. So that was the fundamental idea, and that would be a disruptive change in the industry. And so, you know, we, you know, began a business that made digital music services to deliver digital music.
Got it. So, and I think I heard you get a great saying when you were out raising money for it, which was, it was kind of like TiVo for music.
It was TiVo for music. And TiVo had just had its initial public offering. About a $2 billion market cap. And, you know, I'll tell you, at the time that TiVo had a $2 billion market cap and initial public offering, they had like 500 customers. And, you know, half of them were friends and families of the, you know, the company and the investors. I mean, it was really early. And you couldn't do that today, but, you know, that had been just a monster success. And obviously, it's been a huge success. You could kind of see it, even though it was just nascent. And so, you know, that was a similar idea where you take television content, which was kind of distributed in an old analog way, and make it digital. And so actually the way I fundraised for Music Now is I said, well, I'm going to go to those same investors. They just had a huge payday. And I can go in and I can say TiVo for music. And then I'll have 20 other slides.
But
they want to hear TiVo for music.
And how'd that work?
Like that. I mean, I went, it took me forever.
Secret to venture capital.
It took me forever to get the meeting, you know. I had to work months to get the right introduction, these busy people. And I got there and I said, I'm doing TiVo for music. And they're like, I was already wanting to do TiVo for music. And then I had, like I said, then I had some other slides. It was done.
One slide close, I like it.
One sentence close. it was it. Three words.
So, and as I remember you telling the story, you built a lot of products. I mean, a remarkable number of physical hardware products.
Yeah. When we originally started Music Now, there were no, nothing could play digital music. So in addition to building a service, services like music subscription services and download stores and internet radio services, we thought we had to build the hardware that could actually play it. You can't, you know, if you don't have hardware to play it, it's not going to work. So we built at CES one year, Consumer Electronics Show, which is the big trade show for consumer technology in Las Vegas, we had a suite at the Hilton, and there were four stations in the suite. One was a car stereo that we had built. We partnered with somebody to make a digital car stereo playing our music services. One was a home stereo with an attachment that allowed it to play digital music. Another was a portable device playing digital music, and another was a PC playing digital music. And we, in some cases, we actually did full-on hardware engineering, like the mobile device we built from scratch and plastics and the whole thing. In some cases, like with the PC, we made software. But we made this whole thing, and your music collection would all sync. And, you know, we were there like 4 days, and everyone was interested. So, like, Sony, Compaq, you know, Philips. I mean, everybody came and saw it, you know, one after another. And it wasn't, you know, what we learned was that every one of those companies was right in the midst of making the decision to also make hardware. You know, this was like year 2000-ish.
Yeah. Here at the Consumer Electronics Show, and all the 1,200-pound gorillas there.
Every single one.
Are getting into your business.
They're gonna make these things. And so.
So what do you do when that happens? When you got basically a stampede of gorillas coming at you?
Yeah. So it was great.
Had to be very sobering.
It was sobering, but it was great because there were really two parts to our business. One was the hardware, and the other was the services. So the music services to feed the hardware. And they were all making the hardware, but they weren't making the services. So CES ends, I think, on a Sunday or Thursday or whatever. Fly back from Vegas. You know, by Wednesday, I had laid off the entire hardware part of the company. Like, sorry, guys. I mean, can't do this, you know. And, you know, we're done.
So how'd you get the company to rally around that quick and dramatic of a pivot?
You know, people that work at these kind of companies are really smart. I mean, just what I'm saying to you, like, look, we went there, we met with every single consumer electronics, PC, you know, music, hardware company. They're all doing this. You know, we can't compete with that. But the services that we're making are going to have a huge home. And so, therefore, we are effective immediately. We are out of the hardware business, and we are just going to concentrate on the service. And everybody understood it. You know, I've actually met with some of the people that were the hardware guys, and no hard feelings.
So how did the service work out?
So we, we don't have time to go into all the detail on how ridiculous the early days, and it's still ridiculous, but not as bad, the digital music industry was. You know, how it ultimately worked out is, you know, we became the only business-to-business provider of digital music services. So Rhapsody and Apple were the only two guys that built their own. We built and powered every other digital music service in the market, you know, during that time. Hmm. Earthlink, Charter, Clear Channel, Microsoft, just go down the list. I mean, that was it. It was either Rhapsody, Apple, or us. How it worked out is it would have been a lot nicer had we had Apple. I mean, they kind of took the market over.
And there was kind of a bubble in music in the internet back then, wasn't there?
Yeah, there was the bubble of the internet, and then the bubble that sat on top of that bubble was the digital music internet. And Music Now raised $42 million, I think, somewhere around there. And that's what we kind of brought to invest in that. There were about 50 to 60 other companies that had raised at least that much that were targeting that same industry. Because this was the bubble, and every venture capital firm...
That's $2, $3 billion?
$2, $3 billion, chasing, at that time, what was, at best, a $10 million market. It was crazy.
Wow.
It was insane. It made no business sense. And, you know, I had this little dinky market that, sure, it was going to grow, but it's a little dinky market, and I had 50 competitors that all had at least, you know, $50 million kind of money. The biggest one was Liquid Audio. Liquid Audio raised and spent $1 billion.
Oh, my goodness.
Literally.
Wow.
Going after a $10 million market, and we actually beat them, you know. It was insane. It just didn't make any sense. But it was the bubble. It was the new economy. And like every guy on Sand Hill Road, you know, venture firms in Silicon Valley, everyone had to have a digital music company.
Yeah, sure.
They all did.
So how's this chapter end?
Well, when the bubble was at its height of frenzy, which is also a way of saying its height of stupidity, the mantra was, how fast can you go? Don't worry about revenue. Just aggregate eyeballs. You know, go, go, go. And how fast can you spend? You know, go, go, go. Hire more people. Go, go, go. And so the conventional thinking, particularly the thinking in Silicon Valley, was it was a speed game. And we were probably the first to figure out, no, it was not a game of speed. It was a game of lasting. It was a game of slow. Like, who's going to last? Because the music's going to stop, and there's going to be, like, one or two chairs and a whole bunch of people in the room, and, you know, you got to be one of those guys. And it's going to, and how you would be that is you would last. So it was not how much could you spend, how fast could you go. It's like, how long could you last? Mm-hmm. How much could you save? You know, how little could you spend? And so we figured that out early, fortunately. Watched the whole bubble collapse. All those guys disappeared. And at the end, you know, we were the only business-to-business provider of digital music services. And so we were able to sell the company to Circuit City.
Great. So you end with a win, and you go on to do your next chapter, which is founding Cleversafe, as you said, you know, storing the world's data. But how does one enter a business that big of storing the world's data? I mean, that's a huge idea, which is exciting, but also it's got to be pretty daunting.
You know, I guess I never really thought it was daunting in that sense. You know, if I go back to my Martin Marietta days, I met, you know, because we were the, you know, I was a professional buyer of technology, and I met many, many, many companies in their early, early days and saw them go through that. You know, Microsoft, I remember when Microsoft was 50 people. I remember when Intel, you know, was a little company. Tons of companies like that. And I got to know the people. I would see them go through the phases, and I'm like, yeah, that's, and I was very fascinated by it. So I really would study and kind of follow them over the years. And you can kind of see how, you know, so I had a sense of how you could do that. And the awesome thing about technology is it scales. You know, once you, particularly software, like once you make something that's better, like transformationally better, you know, it's not like you're, I don't know, you know, trying to, I don't know, build a railroad where you just got to keep making more railroad.
So
I mean,
you,
it's like
you
software.
Have, like,
you
did
just
you build
print more
proof of concept? I mean, how'd you attack it early on to sort of help people? Because, you know, you could say that, but it takes, you know, that's a, the destination is a long way away.
Yeah.
So how'd you get people to understand what you were doing?
Yeah, so there were two things, you know, that I did in the very early days of Cleversafe. And I, you know, having done it a few times, you know, these are the two things, you know, now that I'm starting other things too, I mean, it's always, you know, what you want to focus on first. The first thing I did, although I would normally do it second, but I did first, was I wanted to prove to myself, most importantly, that the technology really could do this. And so I wrote, you know, there's a couple of our developers here, that, you know, when they look at my code that I wrote, you know, it's really kind of embarrassing. I'm not a good coder. But I wrote enough to prove to myself, like, this would work, okay? And we've long since replaced it at Cleversafe, you know, with you know, much better stuff. So I built a very early proof of concept, you know, the very basic idea. And then the second thing I did, which I would normally do first, is I wanted to see if customers wanted to buy it. And I wanted to sell it before we had built it. And so the second person I hired was an interface designer. And, you know, I've done a lot of focus groups. So normally in a focus group, you sit there and you have like 10 people from your target market and a moderator, and you show them what it is you're selling. It could be software. It could be, you know, soap. It's the same process. You explain it. Do you want to buy it? And, you know, you ask them questions. And so I said, I want to do focus groups now. And I want to make it so that it looks like we have built this thing. So I hired an interface designer. And what she did is she went to Yahoo Small Business and screen scraped every state of that website, you know, like signing up for an account, you know, all this stuff. And then she, as a graphic designer, would paste on top of that different things, you know, different words, and then eventually built what looked like a completely working system of Cleversafe, which was not at all working. It was just pixel wallpaper. And there was only one sequence the screen should go. It was a presentation that looked like functioning software. And we called it the happy path, meaning this next state of the screen is only, it's only going one direction. There might be 15 buttons, but this thing's only going there, you know. So you would like practice with it, and you could make it look like you're running it, you know, but you're not. You're just, you know, you're like clicking. But that was enough to do focus groups. So we did tons of focus groups. And actually the CEC, this was before 1871, in the early days of the Chicagoland Entrepreneurial Center, I worked with them, and they helped provide, I'd say, I need like people with a home business. I need people with a business of this size. I need enterprise storage decision makers. And they helped put together, and we did focus groups. And so, you know, I look for, you know, how important is digital storage of digital information? What's your willingness to pay? What's your aided and unaided recognition of alternatives? What's your satisfaction with all those alternatives? I mean, all that kind of stuff you do. And the score, it scored off the charts. You know, data was becoming incredibly important. They were dissatisfied with alternatives. They were willing to pay like everything you wanted to see. So that was essential right up front.
So you've got a great idea. You've got a little prototype working that people can see and at least get a feedback on. But our friend Troy Hennicoff likes to say that the life of an entrepreneur looks like an interday trading chart of the, you know,
right.
You don't start here and end here and go up and down like this. Get Troy on his way out.
He's coming back.
But here's the thing. It does have that ups and downs. And a lot of people see where you started, and they see where you end, and they feel the journey is just a hockey stick.
Yeah.
I've never met anybody who rode the hockey stick. I've only met people who live the interday trading chart that Troy talks about. So talk about some of the ups and downs that you all had to navigate to figure out how to help get Cleversafe to achieve its potential.
Well, to build on what you said, not only have you never met, no one's ever met, a company that just experienced this blissful hockey stick. I mean, and you never, like, guys that come here that are like Microsoft or, you know, Steve Case at AOL, I mean, that's never their story. Their story is always the interday trading story. So that is just how it is, period. One of the particular challenges that Cleversafe had, and we went through it, and we there are people that are now trying to do what we did, and we see them going through it, is different technologies have different characteristics in terms of what it's like to make them. In the case of Cleversafe, to build a system to store all the data in the world, it has one particular challenge, one in particular is you can get a bunch of really smart people and they'll scope out the problem and they'll make this project plan and here's what we got to do. And what happens is you get 90% of the way done according to your plan, and at that point in time, you see the second 90%. You realize, I'm only halfway done. There's another 90%. And actually, there's a third 90%. And that, that's a challenge because you're going along, you raise this money, you hire all these people. Like, here we go. We're 70%. We're 80%. We're 50%.
So what was one of those examples where you thought you were at 90 and you realized there was another 90 and then eventually there's 90 behind that? Like, help us. In the Cleversafe story, understand what that feels like, so when people see it themselves, they can recognize it.
Well, there's different answers to that. You know, there's a board meeting answer, which is not a pleasant one, you know, which is you're going to tell your board, like, oh, you know, we're not 90%, we're 50%. That's a difficult conversation. There was a technology version of that, which is, we... the good news, the bad news, the good news is we now know how to do it. The bad news is we got a lot more work to do, is kind of how that worked. And I could go into the detail, like, basically one fundamental thing that Cleversafe does that's very different is every other storage system in the world has either a server or a cluster of servers that manages the metadata, not the actual, let's say you're storing pictures. It's not the pictures, but like the name of the picture and the information, like when was it, saved and who saved and all, like that metadata. And that's a big table. Mm-hmm. And in a really big system, every time you add or change something, you have to make an entry to that table, right? And at some point, you can't make any more entries per second. And that's your limiter. So if you want to store all the data in the world, you can't do that. You cannot build a table that big. So you have to do it a completely different way. And that's what one of the 90% realizations, like, that's got to change. And that's a complete re-architect of the whole system.
It's a fundamental architecture change.
Yeah, that was a
that's
big one.
That's not trivial, as engineers like to say.
Yeah.
So you go through all this, and obviously you've had great success. But this is an expensive thing to do. How much money have you raised this time? And talk a little bit about that path, that journey.
Yeah, so the rule of thumb to build enterprise storage platforms has been you need $200 to $250 million to build one in 5 to 8 years to do it. That is so far beyond the horizon of venture capital, 5 to 8 years. They would just laugh at you if you came in and said, oh, yeah, it's 5 to 8 years. That's
just
the rule of thumb.
Just to build it, let alone build
the business. Yeah, that's when you can start selling. So, in our case, we did it for about $100 million. And I know that sounds like a lot of money, but if you were there at Cleversafe, especially in the early days, and we issued you a desk and a chair, you'd be like, "This is my chair." It was low budget. We really had to be cash efficient to build it for $100 million. So we did it. And there was a lot of challenge in terms of raising that much capital, having that much patience in the capital. And one of the things I did early on, if you look at the kind of investor base at Cleversafe, the last round was led by NEA, kind of a classic venture investor. If you look at the earlier rounds, most of the capital came not from venture, but from families and individuals, wealthy individuals in Chicago. And, they're more thinking kind of generational wealth building, like building wealth for my children. And they were much more tolerant of that longer horizon. And, that actually was one of the advantages for us of being here, was we had access to that capital, and they turned out to be very patient. I don't know if you could have, and actually I've heard this, not just me, but you were talking about Peter Barris from NEA. I've heard from him. I don't know if you could have done that in Silicon Valley.
Interesting. And who are your biggest investors here in town?
So many of the people that are here in town that invest have invested in Cleversafe. We raised $100 million.
See a lot of people on that.
I mean, tons of people. You said you're at a Northwestern meeting just recently, and so Chris Galvin is one of our big investors. Larry Levy is one of our big investors. Ed Kaplan, tons of guys.
I was at lunch today sitting between Peter Barris, Chris Galvin, and Larry Levy, and I said it was you, and they all had fantastic things to say about you. That'd be a great story, but they've obviously, it's been a long journey. When did you start it?
So I started Cleversafe 10 years ago, 2004.
Wow. And so what's your view on, like, in 10 years or 20 years, what do you think Cleversafe is?
Well, what's going to happen in the next 10 years is the amount of data that the world's going to create and store is 100 times what it stores today. And that's a lot more. I mean, it's just, 100 times more. So the systems and the methods that industry has used up until now are really going to fall apart. And so Cleversafe and potentially companies that are able to do what we've done are going to become the new leaders. So that's going to happen. I mean, that's for sure. What will happen for Cleversafe is, we have a leadership position in that. And so we absolutely expect to grow to become the leader in that market. That's the plan. I mean, it sounds easy, in some ways, but like you said, it's that intraday trade chart. It's going to go on for the next 10 years. There's going to be ups and downs, and it's going to be hard, and we're going to have setbacks and, all that kind of stuff. That's just
so
part of it.
You now have brought a CEO in from the outside.
Yeah.
And so how has that been for you?
Well, it all depends upon the person. I mean, mean, that's the obvious answer. And so fortunately, the fit in terms of skills is a great fit. And, you know, John Morris is the guy. I mean, he really knows what he's doing. And, you know, his domain of expertise is very large-scale growth of an enterprise sales organization. He's, you know, he did that at Juniper, grew it by $1 billion. I mean, that's what we plan to do. So, I mean, that's his domain. And, you know, when it's a great guy, it makes it a lot easier. When the guy's not so great, it doesn't work nearly as well. But fortunately, he really knows what he's doing. For me personally, you know, I'm trying to not work 100 to 110 hours a week at Cleversafe. And I'm not doing as well at that as I would like to, and so I'm working on that. You know, to try to get, you know, a little bit more balance. You know, I'm definitely not working super crazy hours, but for the moment, there's just a lot of things going on that I still need to help with, and you know, then there's a lot of great things. You know, a lot of things are happening right now in a positive sense for Cleversafe. So it. In many of them are kind of in domains that I need to help with, so I'm still pretty active.
Great. I know you have to catch a flight, so I want to make sure we take some questions from the audience here. So I'll just read them off. These are the top voted answers here. Is it really feasible to blanket patent distributed data
That's
storage?
Good question. That's a great question. So let me first say I apologize that I'm going to have to scoot here because I have a customer meeting in the morning, and I'm taking the last flight Pittsburgh. But like I said, it's the inner day chart, you know, the work never stops. So the question was, can you blanket enterprise storage with patents? And that's kind of an interesting question.
And it also says, I realize it's smart business, but is it a responsible business practice?
Well, first let me provide a little background on what Cleversafe is doing with regard to patents. And I'll just talk about what's publicly available. So if you go to uspto.gov, the patent office, and you know, do a quick search on patents, assignee name equals Cleversafe, or patent applications, assignee name equals Cleversafe, you'll see that we have a very large number of patents. You'll see about 125 or so issued, and another like 350 applications. And those are just applications that we published long enough that they're now public. There's others as well. So we're creating a massive patent portfolio. I am not going to, I mean, it's not my job to adjudicate whether or not patents are a good thing. Patents exist, and they're an essential part of being an enterprise technology company. And if you want to be a leader in a very large-scale industry, you're going to compete with companies like IBM that has 50,000 or 100,000, whatever they have, patents, you know, and other companies that have thousands. And unless you have currency to bring to that competitive arena, you are very vulnerable. So if you have the ambition to be an enterprise storage leader as a company, and you have to have 1,000 patents, you know, or some number like that to really realize that, without dealing with, because then you can cross license and you have some ability to be viable. So it's essential to do. It's been done before. It's unusual to develop that large of a patent portfolio, but companies have done it as small companies. You know, Qualcomm is a great example. They've been very successful. Dolby Labs has done it. They've been very successful. So it's, in my opinion, it's kind of the, if you want to go dominate a multi-billion dollar technology business, you better bring, you know, hundreds or thousands of patents.
Interesting. Do you have any known competitors doing distributed data storage?
Oh yeah, there are seven large companies that are currently form an oligopoly for large scale enterprise storage systems. And you know, we talked a little bit, EMC, IBM, HP, you know, those kind of guys. And they have their methods, you know, which we're improving upon. And they're very well established and, you know, very capable companies, you know, no doubt about it. They're struggling with kind of building systems that are big enough to handle this new demand. But you know, they're very capable companies, and you know, they're very established competitors.
Why is Cleversafe software limited to Cleversafe hardware as opposed to being available for all existing enterprise hardware?
Well, Cleversafe has really specialized in supporting industry standard hardware. So most enterprise storage hardware is proprietary, you know, designed hardware, and it would be hard for us to support it because it's all kind of custom. But for enterprise standard kind of hardware, we support that in various kinds. So one of our partners is HP. So HP announced a few months ago, you know, some of their big servers are supporting Cleversafe. There's more that are supporting Cleversafe now. So we do support a variety of industry standard platforms today.
On another question, it's got a couple votes on the IP issue. Have you spent more money to protect IP than on building out products? Is that something you have to do in this sort of space?
No. I mean, we spent a lot more. We spent a lot on IP, and we spent a whole lot on building products.
Great. Two last questions I'd like to ask everybody. The first one is, what's your view on Chicago today for startups? If you were starting a company again, we just started here, if you were counseling one of the people out here or watching this on video to want to start a company, would you start it here? Why or why not?
Well, I mean, I guess this easy answer is yeah, it's because of where I live and I don't want to move. But even then, this is my third, you know, I've done three big startups here, I've done all my big startups here, and there are a lot of advantages to being here, and I try to play to the strengths. So at Cleversafe, for example, you know, we have access to there are as many graduates, you know, with technical capability that come out of the schools in the Chicago area as there are in San Francisco area. And, you know, we frankly have a lot less competition, you know, in terms of hiring. So we were able to hire the cream of the crop. And, you know, in some ways I have mixed feelings about all this success on, you know, technology startups here, because there's a lot more competition for these people and it's great for the city. But still, you know, we're able to attract and retain just outstanding people. And that's the whole key. And I actually think that's an advantage. We had a guy in our office 2 weeks ago who was the CEO of one of our partners, another storage company, located in Boston, and he had met with a lot of our people, and he pulled me aside after the meeting. He's like, I can't hire this kind of people, this quality of people in Boston. It's unbelievable how good all your people are. So there's tons of talent here. So I actually think it's an advantage. I think you know, we have lots of engineers that have been with the company, you know, 6, 7, 8 years. That's really hard to do in Silicon Valley. Mm-hmm. So it's really been great for us. So we've played to the strengths of Chicago, and I would continue to do that.
Great. Well, I know we're up at 7:30. You got to catch a flight. Thanks so much for being here. It was great, Chris.
Thanks so much.